formal basis then of our understanding of the Einstein de Sitter universe as it is now known, and of course there has been no refutation of this theory. Thus, in a most general sense, we are engaged then in an eschatological discourse, the philosophy of last things. We need to distinguish between black hole generation as well as strangelets and
black hole generation.
Their generation, that is the generation of strangelets and type 1a supernova, is uncertain, whilst the type 1a supernova of Albert Einstein and Willem de Sitter is almost completely certain. Thus, we have to consider the generalized theory of relativity, and we have then the evidence in the journal Nature to show that all of the experiments then based upon the theory of Albert Einstein are 100% supported, and this would then be another exemplar of this kind of theory being supported by astrophysical observation. But in this case, the astrophysical observation would be done here on our planet. Thus, what we need to say then is we have to have a possibility in terms of what's going on at CERN, the possibility then of forming a breach in the potential barrier towards the center space, and this is then described by Malcolm Perry in his article in the journal Nature, and the energies then from the this kind of current research found that energies at 10 to the minus 9 to 10 to the minus 14 seconds subsequent to the Big Bang at the point origin of the universe, and this penetrance to the center space then becomes almost inevitable as we proceed with further experimentation at CERN. So may we propose then that all who are interested in these questions join with us in a lawsuit before we have this final plunge to our doom with the generation of a type 1a supernova. Now we have then Dr. Richard Wagner, who himself is a lawyer, and he has now presented this in a formal court proceedings in Honolulu, and we're now in the process of appeal to this court in Honolulu at this time. So please join with us, if you will, in pursuing this suit to bring a halt to these proceedings. The central theory, then, that we have cited here is the general theory of relativity of Albert Einstein, which is very well respected and established in the field of physics. And also we have then the standard model of physics, which was begun in the 1970s. The standard model is incomplete since it does not encompass gravitational phenomena, since it is the extension then of the generalized theory of relativity, which predicts to De Sitter space and its energies. This would be completely reliable and an established prediction, based then on modern relativistic cosmology. Thus, we need to wait for the confirmation of this prediction with the generation of a type 1a supernova from Fermilab, Brookhaven, or CERN. Billions of dollars then are being spent in the pursuit of the confirmation of the existence of De Sitter space in the Einstein De Sitter universe at its now term. In terms of our evidence then from astrophysical observation, other evidence for the intrusional events from De Sitter space may be noted in the monopolar jets from quasars. These objects are 4 to 5 times larger than bipolar objects, where the fluxional energetics of these variables is measured in millions of galaxies. It would appear plausible to assume that there is a unique source of energetics for these larger objects, in other words, to consider space. There is thus a dichotomous distinction between class 1 and class 2 objects, and we would find then that the class of objects then which are larger would have access then to consider space. We also have then the notion in this theory of type 1a supernova. These supernova then are sufficiently uniform as to be used as standard candles in observational cosmology, while they are believed to form in the neighborhood of stars that are, in a sense, being siphoned off of hydrogen to form a sufficient mass to produce the implosion necessary for supernova generation from a white dwarf. There is no trace of hydrogen at the time of maximum light. Also, the process of ignition is not known. The hypothesis, then, that I am presenting is that sentient entities, much like ourselves, create type 1a supernova, and this is therefore very straightforward. Should we be the only ones to create, then, type 1a supernova, this would, in a sense, go against the uniformity of nature. If, on the other hand, they are noted arising as uniquely bright events that outshine their respective galaxies of origination throughout the cosmos, this would indicate that the possibility of causing type 1a supernova from experimentation is a frequent and uniform event.